The name Ellington is synonymous with music, with composing, arranging, and performing it. There were two iconic Ellingtons. There was the father and the son. But then there was their mistress, the music. I'm Fred Macy, and you're listening to The Jazz Scene, dedicated to the preservation, promotion, and appreciation of jazz, America's classical music. A few years ago, I had the distinct honor and the true pleasure of talking with Duke Ellington's son, Mercer, an accomplished and legendary musician-composer in his own right. We sat down in the dining room of his Park Avenue apartment in Manhattan with a big pot of coffee and a huge pile of Danish in the center of an enormous white linen-covered table. Visiting for nearly 2 hours, we chatted about everything from making music to his loving but sometimes stormy relationship with his dad, the Duke. This is the first of three fascinating parts, an intimate view of a famous father through the eyes of his son as he tries to climb out from under a giant shadow, vivid recollections of not one, but two storied careers.
Mercer Ellington, what is your own personal philosophy about music? What should music be?
I don't know. I wish I had something more definite to say, but I think I'm still developing or changing in my opinion about the way it is and how it should work. Music is a, well, first, a language of communication. And secondly, it should represent what you do from one day to the next. And it's in a way, a story of your own life as you live it from one day to the next. And you can tell by the titles of various people who've written things. For instance, Johnny Hodges and I wrote a tune with Johnny Hodges called Tale of the Fox. And we were playing a place that night when we thought of the tune. And so we decided we'd dedicate it to the place that sort of caused us to think about it.
And on where you hand, were right at the time,
yeah. But on the other hand, it should also be something that makes the listener feel what you're feeling. And you're onto this when you go someplace like Russia, and there's no way in the world that you're going to get around to being able to talk to these people in their own tongue, but that you can do a certain kind of a music for that audience and then have them rave or clap their hands or be very silent at a time when you want to be emotional and all, and you know you've gotten your word to them.
Yeah.
So that I think basically music should be a living thing that's relative to what you are and what you're about and a way to keep in touch with people.
How do you think your philosophy has changed through the years? Has it changed through the years?
Well, the reason it's changing is because I'm not influenced by the people that I've idolized. Can't be influenced by them because they're gone. And now I'm really on my own, and I've got to think in terms of how to be genuine. I don't have anybody anymore to slap my wrist and say, well, you're in a strange position, or we don't do this, and this isn't done like the rules that I had to learn in 1927 when I first went out with the band. Johnny Hodges, well, Johnny wasn't even there then, but Harry Connick would say, well, you got to conduct yourself in a certain way, you're Duke Ellington's son, and so forth. Now I don't have that advice, and I wish I did, but I'm even in a more detrimental position because what I do is advice now not only to my own children, but to other people's children. And now I'm in a position of having to set down the rules, and it's a terrible responsibility.
Yeah, I bet it can be.
Right.
Let's drop back a little bit and think back to your very first musical recollection. What would that be if there was one moment when you first heard any kind of music, whether it was jazz or something else, and you said, wow, I've got to be a part of that?
That's very easy because it stays fixed in my mind. That was in 1927 at Salem, Massachusetts. And I looked up and I saw these six people on the stage, not six, eight actually, having a wonderful time. And I said, well, that's what I want to do. I want to have fun for the rest of my life.
What were they doing?
Well, I was Duke Ellington.
It was
playing a dance.
So it was your dad's band?
Yeah, So it worked out very well. Like, I was on vacation. It was, you know, like seeing the entire world of, like, a trip into space.
You've had some fun with it.
Oh, yeah. I mean, it's life itself. And I got this philosophy from parents of one of my best friends, Luther Henderson. We grew up together in New York. And I was a little ashamed because my grades weren't exactly right when I was going to Columbia. Now, I told him, I said, Mr. Henderson, he was about 80 then. I said, here you are. I mean, you got all these degrees. You've done this great studying and everything else. And I'm struggling trying to get through so I can just get a diploma and a bachelor's on this one subject. And I feel like I'm nuts, you know, like I can't apply myself well. So he says, there's nothing to be ashamed of. He says, I'm doing this because I enjoy doing it. He said, it's not that I have any great talent. I just do it because it's something I want to do. And he said, if you go through life and you do something that you want to do, he said, you're living. But otherwise, he said, you got a job. You know, you're doing it because you want to pay the rent.
You've been living, or have you had a job?
I felt that I've been living. I've lived every bit of it, and I've had responsibilities and a mortgage to meet and things of that sort. But it was even like when I was with the old man, if there was some kind of way we could enjoy ourselves, we didn't worry about what happened tomorrow. We'd have civil service one day and hamburgers the next, and maybe not the next.
When did you first realize that your dad was somebody special, that he wasn't like maybe some other kids' dads?
Well, I guess when I first heard him on radio, because radio was such a highly special thing in those days, you know, it was like cylinders in a Cadillac, and depending on how well off you were as to how many batteries you had on the radio.
Yeah.
And we had my father coming to us over the radio, and we had these 18 batteries on the radio that it was playing, so then I knew he had to be a big man.
And he was an 18 battery man.
Yeah, right there.
How do you think that affected your growing up, as opposed to growing up like just a kid whose dad might have been an officer or factory worker?
Well,
obviously it got you involved with music, but socially and in other ways, how did that impact?
What happened to me was something that was good in a way and also bad in a way. I mean, kids should not have their children split up, or their parents split up. And mine was separated from about the time I was 8 years old. So I spent my year between the two homes. And when I was with my father, there was a lot of luxury involved in it. And when I was with my mother, we were living a very average life, and there was nothing very special about it. And we weren't poor or anything of that sort, but we were certainly not rich. And there were certain things we used to have to do in order to get things straight. And as a result, I became the richer for being able to appreciate how good it was to be average. Because even at a younger age, and kids are sensitive to these things, when you're specialed out for not so much what you are, but who you are. And it puts you in an embarrassing situation. You don't know how to come up with answers when people ask you questions about your father and Duke and this and Duke that. You lose your identity. They're not talking about Mercer, they're talking about Duke. And when I was with my mother, I was Mercer. I knew who I was. And the people that I met, I could be very certain, were genuine friends. I got to the place where I began to resent being in positions that I was being accorded a courtesy because I was Duke Ellington's son instead of Edna's son.
Yeah.
And I would be very angry because I knew I wouldn't be treated this way if I was just an average person. And I wanted it to be such that I could depend on this no matter what my situation was or might become.
You wanted to be your own person.
That's right.
Yet you had kind of a unique setup because you were able to, I guess, to some extent, enjoy both aspects, being the son of somebody famous and at the same time just being a regular Joe, more or less.
Right. Like you say, you know, the idea of security. I mean, you know, knowing what your place was and where you were, it's important.
When Duke and your mom split up, he harbored, I guess, a certain resentment toward her, and yet, from what I understand, you remained, as one book said, faithful to her.
You know,
and this kind of irritated him a little bit, didn't it?
Yeah, but just because you get mad with somebody doesn't mean you stop loving them.
Right.
And as I also said, you know, your relatives are some of the best people to hate because you do love them.
You can't feel hate unless you have love for someone, I think. You don't care otherwise.
Nothing can be taken away from you if you don't have anything to lose.
You and your dad had a lot of differences over the years. You struggling, I guess, for your identity and him struggling, in a sense, to keep you in your place, so to speak. What kind of a dad was he? What kind of a father was he?
Well, he was a very definite, I mean, in a way he was not a father type. But he did things that fathers would do, you know.
Such as?
Well, he wanted to, I guarantee you, you know, like they say, what is your child doing tonight? Well, Ellington knew where I was all the time. Not because he was looking after me or falling behind or asking me at the end of the day, what did I do? But he had people spotted to check me out.
Really?
Know exactly what was going on with me. And as a result, you know.
Well, did you feel kind of spied on? Or?
Well, I mean, basically that's what it was, the spy system. And we were in Los Angeles one night, and he knew I had been out, you know, I'd been on him. And Ellington could get you. You know, he didn't give a damn how long he had to wait. But he could see to it that he would get to the place where he would grab you for something that you might have done. And you don't even know the blow is hit, and he's struck.
Really? Yeah, he was settling.
Right, and this night he knew what I had been doing. He knew that I'd been hanging out. And I had been jumping on him because of late, I hadn't had a chance to write anything for the band. So he waited until I was highly vulnerable, out of it at 4 o'clock in the morning. The word is drunk. And he came.
Overpartied.
Up, right. Yeah. And he says, we got a record session at 8 o'clock in the morning, and I want you to have a tune ready. Oh, so this is your opportunity that you've been asking for, right?
And he picked that moment to give it to
you. Yeah, he picked that moment because he knew that that I wasn't in any shape. So I snatched up everything I could do, and went in there and threw this tune at him. Anything I had ever heard from anywhere that came easy, I wrote down on the paper. It turned out to be a tune called Things Ain't What They Used to Be, which is the biggest thing I've ever written.
You should have partied more often.
Yeah. There's got to be some kind of a lesson in that. He would never tell me and teach me what music he taught. He said, you put two notes together, and if it sounds pleasant to you or if it represents the way you feel, then you know that you can use those. And he said, and then put a couple more notes in there somewhere else. And if it represents the way you're feeling, then you're succeeding in what you're writing. And if you want to call it a set of rules, he said, well, you have to learn the blues and what that does, and mention several other standard type tunes like I Got Rhythm. And he's written so many things off of that. Between I Got Rhythm and Tiger Rag, Ellington must have written 30 tunes on
just based on those two.
Yeah, just on those changes. But that gives you an idea of his being able to check up on me, know what I was doing. And he never admonished you. You know, he never said, well, you must do this, you must do that.
What was your relationship like in a non-musical sense? Did you have a non-musical relationship with him as father and son?
We had basic arguments. And whenever we had a basic argument, the argument was inspired by my wanting to take care of him and something I felt was absolutely necessary. For instance,
you take care of him.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
And we had one absolute argument that was lasted forever, and that was about New York City and the Rainbow Grill. When he first went there, he had a very successful engagement because they had just done Anatomy of a Murder, and they took the basic people who did the picture to do a premiere, and they went from the premiere to the grill for about 4 or 6 weeks. So every time he'd come back into New York, he would break the band down and take a small group up there. And I claim that New York is the top of the world. And if when you come in here, you got to put your best foot forward and you got to show your absolute whole and everything that you do, which is the correct thing to do, not go up there and take requests like you have to do when you first start out a band and somebody says, I want to hear Mame, and another half-drunk guy is sitting back there and says, Gal of My Dreams, and no musical taste involved. And here's a man who's a creator. So I felt that he should be where he represents what he did. He was the only one that had the guts in a sense through the years to, in the majority of occasions, to play only his music. Because, I mean, this can be death to you, because people will just walk on you. We had the experience of playing in bars. People didn't like what you were doing. They leave a half a glass of beer. That half a glass of beer got to be one of my greatest evidences of barometers in the business.
Really?
When a man who drank beer, bought beer, he bought it because he didn't want to have a lot of money to spend. And if he was willing to leave a half a glass of beer,
he knew something was wrong.
You know, it was a total criticism.
How did your relationship with your dad change over the years as you got older? Did you find you were getting a little more respect, that he was giving you a little more slack? Or
no,
did he always keep you kind of over here as the kid?
As we got older, I became the parent, and he became the child, to the extent that... Mainly, I would see to it, all he had to do and worry about was to come in, take his hat off, sit down at the piano and play. And if he chose to be a little late, we went to work without him. And when he was ready to come in and take over, that was it. And we played things which would not interfere with his coming in to be the big success. We played around him. If we did a concert, maybe I'd be 20 minutes on the stage just running some of the numbers down before he'd come. And then if we played a dance, he might sit out the whole first set.
Really? Now, is this more in the later years, or was this an habitual type thing?
No, it was, you know, particularly if we were like in a hotel where he was housed, he would stay up and see the end of his TV program before he came down, regardless of what time the contract said you hit.
Now, was that because he had confidence that he knew you could carry it, or whether he just didn't give a damn and you were saving him?
It wasn't so much he knew I could do it. He knew Harry Connick had been doing it for years. Harry Connick did what I had begun to do.
Okay.
And Harry would sit down there, and they had four numbers they always played, and they started playing that whether he was there or not. They started on time.
Okay.
The other thing was to get him to make a decision. That was the most difficult procedure. And he would never, you know, you would swear he was a presidential candidate. He never took any particular side where the votes could go against him. So when you say, well, shall we go by bus to Philadelphia, or should we take the train, or shall we fly, or what? And if so, what time? No answer whatsoever. The only way you could get an absolute reaction from him is to just make a statement. We're going to take flight number so-and-so to California that leaves at 8 o'clock and arrives wherever we're going at a certain time. He said, what the hell you want to do that for? You need to do so-and-so. And then he come up with an absolutely detailed plan, when if we took the bus, we took route so-and-so, route 80 across to Albany, and then you turned and went onto the highway and went into the certain place.
But you had to take a stand first.
You had to say something and then make him contradict you, and then you got absolute instruction.
Did he ever just agree?
Not hardly. He had two things that I remember most about hanging with him. First off, if you named a city, he could tell you what the morning paper was in that town.
Right.
And if you named any two places in the United States, he could tell you what routes to take to get from one to the other. It was because of this kind of a memory that he used to do some things that seemed phenomenal. We were on our way to California in 1940, and they were screaming for the music to jump for joy. And the music didn't arrive, and we got as far as Salt Lake City, which was only like about another day and a half into LA, and he sat up one night and he did three arrangements, complete. He wrote three songs by the time we arrived, and incidentally, the three tunes he wrote that night was Brown Skin Gal and Calico Gown, Jump for Joy, and I Got It Bad and That Ain't Good.
Just wrote them that night.
Wrote and arranged them in one night. And he did In a Sentimental Mood in a four-hour bus trip. He started writing it on the way in. And by the time we arrived, he'd finished it. And the band went on stage and started playing. And by the time he got through his second set, they played In a Sentimental Mood that night for the first time.
Really? So actually, it sounds like he worked very much according to mood. If he just wanted to kick back, whether the band was on or not, he'd do it. But when he felt like working, he really went with all cylinders.
Well, he always felt like working. And the point is, regardless of what happened, he didn't let it interfere with his feeling. He would leave you in the middle of a room. I mean, we could, four of us could be sitting here. And all of a sudden, he'd take out a piece of paper or do something and sit there. And if you said anything relative to him or whatever, he was oblivious to it. If you try to get him to answer a question or whatever, he just sit there and grunt. He's going, And that's it, and just keep on writing. He wouldn't make himself a part of it. It was as if he had left the room completely.
Yeah, you could just switch it off like that. You've called him Pop and Ellington, and today we're talking, you called him the old man several times. I've always wondered how much reverence is in that. Is that a term of affection, or is that just sort of was that particularly when he was alive, just sort of a little needle when you called him Pop? How do you feel about that? And how did you mean it?
Well, it's because in being with him, I had both roles. I had the role of being, of working for an employer. I had the role of being his son. I had the job of familiarizing people with him. So if some reporters would come in to do a story on him from one place to the other, I said, now, this man has been in business for better than 25 years. There have been articles written about him, books and so forth. If you don't want to come up on the amateurish side, don't start asking him the story of his life. There's too much to it. You don't have time enough to get involved in it.
Yeah.
I will familiarize you with some of the facts about him and so forth and so on. And then I just relate something as if I was talking about Debussy or whatever.
Yeah.
So in this instance, I was being the objective person. When we talked with each other, we never addressed each other. You just started talking. You know, I wouldn't say Pop so-and-so and so-and-so. I'd just say, we're going into so-and-so. Or that's it, and he turned around and do the same. So very seldom did one of us have a name for the other.
Yeah.
So I talked more about him than I did to him.
Was that a conscious thing? Not having a name for each other?
I don't know how it came about or whatever. But, you know, most people also address each other according to the way the parents talk to each other. In other words, a child comes up, he hears his mother and father talking to each other. And so in order to educate the child, the mother will say, Father, did you do so-and-so today, and so forth and so on. So now the child knows that you talk to this gentleman as being father. And he says, Mother, so-and-so and so-and-so, and the child begins to call the lady of the marriage the mother, right?
Usually. Yeah.
I was growing up with my parents, my mother addressed my father as Ellington.
You just called him Ellington.
Yeah, so Ellington was so-and-so. So that's how I got used to, I guess, just using the name and talking to him. And basically it's an endearing term, but it sounds like it's on the cold side.
And Pop was an endearing term as well.
Well,
was that a needle?
I guess that developed in later years because I had to abandon the real name I had for him. When I was really growing up, coming out of my baby days, my name for him was Fadu.
Fadu?
Yeah. And that was because I couldn't pronounce Father Duke.
Okay.
So gradually, all of a sudden, it became too childlike, and I abandoned and got away from him. As far as he was concerned, he never had problems pronouncing his name for me, which is simply Brat.
My father used to call me Listen. He always said, Listen,
hey,
Brad. Stupid.
So that was it.
Hey, Brad.
Yeah.
So Mercer was the brat. Well, exactly how did the Duke relate to his family, to other musicians? Was he a better composer or a better musician? Don't miss part two of my interview with Mercer Ellington here at the Mark of Jazz. I hope you've enjoyed our conversation and Mercer's complete openness and honesty in sharing his story. If you'd like to hear anything special, or just want to talk about the things you like best, be sure to leave me a comment either here at the Jazz Scene or on the website itself, markofjazz.com. Until next time, let me remind you of a profound bit of wisdom, compliments of the great Miles Davis, who said, "Don't play what's there, play what's not there."